without taking more time, I'm introducing David, who will speak about Elasticsearch, and I hope that everyone will enjoy. I know that we will enjoy the advanced part, not the legacy part.
Thank you so much. Good morning, everyone. We speaking French here?
No.
One. On two, okay. So this talk will be in English because I don't speak Bulgarian, but it will be in French English, okay? So I hope that you will be able to understand. So this talk is about exactly my own experience. I have been working for the French Customs previously, and what I'm going to describe today is exactly my journey at the French Customs when I discovered Elasticsearch, and I wanted to add it to my legacy application. Actually, the application I was building, but it was yet legacy. So I'm going to teach you, and I expect that you will learn from that today. So, during the session, you can ask for any question on slido.com with the hashtag Elastic, and if you do that, at the end, you can vote for the other question from the others, and at the end, if I have enough time, I will answer the question. If I don't have enough time, I will answer the question on Twitter, right? So feel free to ask any question there, and I will answer you. Well, I need to exit that. Okay. So, I'm working at Elastic. I have been working for 5 years now. And at Elastic, we are building what we call the Elastic Stack. And the Elastic Stack is built on many open source projects. The two projects that we are going to see today are Elasticsearch. We are mostly going to focus on Elasticsearch. Elasticsearch is basically a server where you index JSON documents and you can retrieve the documents in an easy way with nice API. It can scale out, deals with petabytes of data if you have. So we will see that. And then you have Kibana. Kibana is the UI that you put on top of Elasticsearch, and you can visualize things. We will see that at the end, if I have time. And you can also use Kibana as a developer console, and this is what I'm going to use today, actually. Still, on the open source part, we have two ingest layers that we call Bits and Logstash. So Bits are agents that you put on your physical machine. And if you want to ship the logs, for example, from Bits to Elasticsearch, you can use FileBit for that. It will stream your logs to Elasticsearch. If you want to understand what is happening on the network card, then you can use PacketBit for that. It will do like Wireshark on the network card and then send all the data to Elasticsearch. Metric bit for metrics, obviously, and a lot of things like this. And Logstash is the ETL, where you can extract from a source, transform the data on the fly, and then load that to Elasticsearch or to other destination. So basically, this is the open source stack that we, as Elastic, are providing. And then, as a business, we are extending the feature of the stack with what we call XPAC. So XPAC provides security, alerting, monitoring, reporting, machine learning, graph exploration, what have you. So this is the commercial part. And if you don't want to manage all that by yourself, we have an Elastic Cloud offer, which is available. And you can run also this same offer on your premise, on your own data center, if you wish, with the what we call the Elastic Cloud Enterprise version. That's all for the sales part, I would say. So I'm David Pilato on Dadune on Twitter. So if you follow me, and if you take some pictures as well and tweet about the session, please use the hashtag Elasticsearch, because I'm paid by the number of tweets that I'm getting, so please. So yeah, Dadune on Twitter. And then if you ask questions, I will answer there. So as I said, I joined the company 5 years ago, and I have been working on Elasticsearch project itself. So I'm somewhere here. I have been working a lot on plugins, the open source plugins, that was my main activities. And starting a year ago, or more than a year ago, I moved to more an evangelist position, which explained that I have less commit now in the repository. But I'm still working sometimes when I have time, well, during holidays, on Elasticsearch. So I'm going to start the session today from this repository. And if you want to do again the same session that I'm going to run today, you can just fork this project And you have multiple branches here. I'm going to go through all those branches, but live. And if you want to understand what I did between two branches, you just have to compare the branch, and then you will be done, basically. There is a README file where you just have to follow the guide, and that's it. So I will tweet about this repository after the session as well. Okay, so let's start now. So let's say I have already an application running, and this is the case here. I started my application yet. And the use case I have is about marketing data. I have, I'm dealing with people, person. So I have, what is that? No, this is a table. This is the bins part. On the Java side, I have a person bin where I have some attributes like the name, date of birth, gender, number of children. And I have also other bins like marketing data, counters. I'm not going to use that here. And I have also the address here, so country, city, and geolocation point, which is latitude and longitude. Okay, so this is the data that I have, not the data, the model that I have. If you look at what I have on the database side, I'm using MySQL here behind the scene. I have a person table, which is for the person bin here, and the marketing table for the marketing bin, and the address and geopoint are wrapped together inside the address table. So this is what I have to start with. I'm using Hibernate here for my use case. I'm just going to show you some part of the code. So anytime I want to save an entity in the database, I'm using Hibernate here. I'm starting a transaction, saving the entity to the database, and then committing the transaction. Basically, this is what I'm doing. I will show you the search part just after. So let's have a look at the application. So what I want to provide to my user is a simple search box, like Google search box, where I want to be able to search for my person in my database. So for now, I did not inject anything. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to run this injector, like I want to inject 10,000 documents, for example. So those are going to be generated randomly, and they are going to go through the save method that I mentioned. Those things are going to be saved in the database, which means that I will be able to search for them. So I did not show you what is the search yet, but I can search, for example, for Joe. Okay, it's working like this. I have also the advanced search, where I can search specifically for within the name field, Joe, country field, France, and city, Paris. Okay. So this is what I have now. Let's have a look at the code. So let's have a look at the search method. Okay. So when I'm searching a la Google, I'm getting what the user has entered as a parameter here. And I'm doing this call here, which is here. So I'm using Hibernate again. Again, I'm generating a query. And if we look at what I did, I just wrapped what the user has entered with the person sign. I'm doing a join with the address table because I want to be able to search by name or also by city or country, so I need to do that. And then whatever the user has entered, I'm trying to search for that in the name field, address.country and address.city. Okay, this is what I'm doing now. If we look at the other implementation, the advanced search, this is super similar. I'm getting from the interface a name field from the form, a country field, and a city field. And if name has been set, then I want to search specifically within the name field, or for country address.country, and for city address.city. Okay, it's pretty obvious. Okay, so everything is working, apparently. So I can search for Joe, yes. So why we are here, actually? What are the problems? So I can search for Joe Smith. Okay, cool. I can search for Smith. Oh, Smith Joe does not exist. Actually, I know this guy exists, but yeah, my user reverted the first name and the last name, so it does not match. Remember the query that we did? I'm just wrapping with the Smith Joe with person sign, and as in the name field, I don't have Smith Joe but Joe Smith, it does not match. Right? This is the issue we have. I could split the text on the space and try to combine different kind of flag, but yeah, it's not straightforward. Okay, I can search gsmooth, I'm a user. Oh no, it does not work. How can I fix that? Maybe I should try to add a question mark and try to combine that on all the letter. Yeah, it's not going to work. I can search within the country field. Yeah, this one is super interesting. Can you see something strange here? Yeah, we have here Italy. This is not the issue, actually. The issue I have is that, okay, it matched because the name is France Gall. Who knows France Gall? Someone? Okay. She was a famous singer in France. She passed away this year, sadly. That was one of my favorite singers, but okay, anyway. So the problem that I have here is that France Gall is not on the top of the list. And to me, for my use case, I feel like that because I'm searching for France, and France is matching on the name field, and this is a pretty much a unique name, I would expect it to be on the top of the on the result, right? When I'm searching on Google, for example, or Quant, the search engine, I'm not going through all the pages to find the right match. I'm expecting to have on the top of the first page the result that I'm looking for. And obviously, this is not happening here. So we need to fix that. And to fix that, I want to use the best search engine ever, which is Elasticsearch. But I'm biased. I'm working at Elastic, you know. So, but still, I feel like it's the best one. The question is now, how are you going to send the data to Elasticsearch, actually? So there are several options. You can use an ETL like Talend or Mule ESB, for example, and you can say every 5 minutes, read the content that you have in the database, transform that to JSON document, and then index that inside Elasticsearch. You can use Logstash also for that, obviously. It's made for that. But what is the issue with that? Anytime my user is going to save and to click on the Save button in my application, I will have to wait for 5 minutes that the batch run, take the data, and index it inside Elasticsearch. So it's not real time, and to be honest, I don't like it. It can work for some use cases, but for my use case, I don't like it. And how do you deal with updates every 5 minutes? Are you going to get again the full data and then reindex everything, or do you want to just get a subset, what has been modified? If you want to do that, it means that you need to add a technical field in your table, which is the last modified timestamp, something like this. What about deletes? When you remove something in the database, the batch is running. You need to be aware that something which is not coming back, because it has been removed, must be removed. So this is super hard to solve. You can do that with triggers, or maybe you can add a technical table somewhere to deal with that, but again, it's not my favorite way to do that. So if you can, and this is what I would really recommend doing, I would recommend sending the data to Elasticsearch within the same transaction as you are sending the data to the database, right? So like a Y mechanism. So this is what I'm going to show you now. So I want to do that. I'm using Hibernate, I said, and Maven here. So I'm going to add a dependency to the Elasticsearch client. Here, so I'm using the latest version of Elasticsearch that we released. and in my person service, what I just said is that anytime I'm saving an entity in the database, I want to save it in Elasticsearch as well. So I'm going to create a DAO object, implement a save method, and I want to save this person object. So let's create a field here that will be final Elasticsearch DAO. I need to create this class, DAO package. Okay. I'm using here a framework named RESTX, which is super similar to Spring Boot. So I have annotation and I can inject the components, which I'm going to do here. Okay. So I have here my Elasticsearch DAO, which means that I can start to implement now this method. Okay. Void. So, what do I need to communicate with Elasticsearch? The first thing I need to add is an Elasticsearch client. So let's add a private final REST high-level client. Let's call it ES client. Oops, here. I need to initialize it. Okay. And this is how you can initialize the client. So basically what I'm saying, I'm building this REST high-level client class from what we call the low-level client here. And this low-level client is going to connect to Elasticsearch on local machine on the default port. Okay? This is a REST API that is exposed by Elasticsearch. Okay, we have a client, we need something else. I'm not sure I mentioned that yet, but Elasticsearch picks JSON only. It means that you need to convert your entities, your bins, to JSON documents. So to do that, we have a very nice library named Jackson that I'm going to use here. And Jackson exposes the Object Mapper class, which is super handy. And because I have that provided by RESTX, I'm just going to inject that here. Okay, so I have everything I need to implement my save method now. First thing, I'm going to write the object person as bytes or strings, whatever. Here. And I can have that. And this is my JSON document. Okay, so here in JSON, I have a JSON representation of my bin. And then I'm going to call the client. I want to index something. I'm going to create an index request. So what is the index name? So by default, I'm going to create an index name person. Elasticsearch is a multi-tenancy system, so it means that you can have multiple indices running within the same cluster. You need to add, for now, a type, which is going to be removed in the future. So let's use doc. And I'm going to use here the ID that has been generated by Hibernate, so I will be in sync by the ID on Elasticsearch side and on MySQL side. Okay. I need to add the JSON document itself, so it will be something like this. So the JSON, and I'm going to say this is JSON content. So basically, with those two lines of code, I'm able to send data inside Elasticsearch. Okay, it's not super hard to do that. Let's compile this, and let's see what is happening. I expect to have an error. Yeah. So here, I can have an exception while I'm communicating with Elasticsearch. Maybe Elasticsearch is down or what have you. So what should I do in that case? I'm going to write pseudocode just to explain what you could do. This is not typically what you should do in production, but just you to understand. So maybe what you can do is something like this. I have an exception. Let's just roll back what is happening on the database side. Okay. For my use case, that was the case in French customs, I did not want to do that. Because to me, it was super important and super critical that any time the user click on the save button, the data is saved in the database. Whatever is happening on the search layer. Search is less important than saving entities to me. So I said, okay, instead of doing that, what I did is something like this. Actually, I did not really do that, but okay. Houston, so let's warn the team, the ops team. Problem. Cool message. Okay. No, normally what you should do, and this is what I did, I was sending the person bin that I'm not been able to save in that to inside Elasticsearch to a message queue system. And then anytime Elasticsearch was back, I was reading the message queue again, and I was then streaming all the errors again to Elasticsearch, something along those lines. OK, I mentioned also the delete problem. What can you do when you delete something in database? Here, it's super straightforward. You can call the Elasticsearch DAO again, implement a delete method within the same transaction again, and say, remove the person by its ID, and create this method. This is the ID. And how do you do that in Elasticsearch? It's simply call the delete method, create a delete request here. What is the index name person? The type doc, and the ID ID. And that's basically it. Let's compile that again. So super easy again to remove a document. Okay, it's working. So I'm going to restart the application, but first I need an important piece here, which is Elasticsearch itself. So I have here a Docker compose YAML file here. So I'm using the latest version of the stack with some images. So we'll start Elasticsearch and Kibana all together here. So let's do Docker compose up. It's time for a break. So we need to wait a bit that everything is starting. Is that okay so far? Is my French English okay? Okay, thank you. Revive, no living connection, blah, blah, blah. So Elasticsearch started, and I think that Kibana is ready now. So I'm going to open Kibana. No, not yet. Here we go. So I have a brand new Kibana instance. I'm not going to go through the menu here. This is not the purpose of the talk. I'm just going to go to this page. So what I need to do here, what I can do, I can use the developer console, which is exactly that. Instead of running curl command manually, I can here just send basic command to Elasticsearch, like get slash. And I can do something like get slash cat slash indices. So you can see you have auto-completion, which is super handy. So I have only internal indices. And if I'm doing person, yeah. So I don't have any index name person so far, right? I did not create anything yet. So let's start the application now and see what is happening. And while this is running, I need to sublime, what is the name? I did forget about that, sorry. Stop it here, okay. Oops, I'm sorry. So, the project has been restarted. Let's see what is happening now. So I need to obviously index some documents inside the database and Elasticsearch. So I'm going to start like with 1,000 documents first to see what is happening. So look at this rate. This is the rate that we have been able to index the data inside the database only so far. So let's see if it has any impact. Obviously it does. So it's not really ideal here. But let's have a look at what we have. So we can see that now that our index is coming, and I have new data coming. You can see the count increasing. So anytime I'm saving something in database, it's saved in Elasticsearch. And I can run a basic search here, which is a match all query. Give me everything that you have. And you get back something like this JSON response, where you can see I have that number of hits so far. And those are the top 10 documents. And you can see here within the source field, actually the bin that has been transformed by JSON. Okay, so this is the JSON representation of the entities that I'm also saving in the database. Okay, good. But for now, when we are searching here, we are still searching in the database, right? I did not change the search part. So let's modify that now. We are going to go to the person service here, layer. Yep, here. So the search method that we shown before, let's remove that and let's replace that with an Elasticsearch implementation now. So I'm going to use what we call a query builder. So I'm going to build a query. And I'm going to say that if you, which one? This one, not this one. This one is empty. Oh, this one. So if I have nothing entered by the user, the query I want to build is the one I just mentioned before, is what we call the match all query. Give me everything that you have. Otherwise, if the user has entered anything, the query I want to build is another one, builders. And I'm going to use what we call the multi-match query here. So what I'm searching for? Q. And I can say, okay, I want to search for Q within the name field, the address.country field, address.city. And because everything is indexed by Elasticsearch by default, you can also search within the gender field if you wish. Okay? So I have my query ready here. What I need to do now, I need to call my Elasticsearch DAO and say, okay, let's implement a search method. I'm going to pass the query that I just built, and I'm just going to show you how you can deal with pagination with the from and size parameter. Let's create this. This is a query from and size parameter. Okay, we need to implement this thing. So let's call the search method. I'm going to create a new search request. As I said, Elasticsearch is a multi-tenancy server, so you can search across multiple indices, but here I just want to search within the person index. Let's add the exception. Here, I need to provide a source, and this is a new search. Oops. New search source builder. What is the query? The query that I built. And to deal with pagination, you have simply from and size parameter, so it's super straightforward. If you had to deal with that on a SQL database, you know that it's painful sometimes. Okay, this is giving me back a response. And then I can return this response to the caller. Okay. So here I have a response. So my application is not that legacy. I'm not using struts or whatever you on the front end. I'm using here AngularJS. So because the purpose of the talk is about the back end, not the front end. So I'm cheating a bit. Everything is ready already on the website part. So I'm just sending the JSON document response from Elasticsearch to the front. This is what I'm doing here. Okay, I'm ready for the simple search, the Google search. I can do the same thing for the advanced search. I'm going to type super fast. Yeah, very fast. So, what I'm doing here, I'm saying that if the user has not entered anything in the name field, country field, and city field, then run a match all query. Otherwise, create what we call a Boolean query. And if the user has entered anything in name form, it must match on the name field. If the user has entered anything in the country field, it must match on the address.country. And same for address.city. Okay? Easy. And then I'm calling exactly the same method. So I think I'm done with that. So let's restart the application and see that in action now. Okay. So now I'm not using anymore the database, but I'm using Elasticsearch to search. Okay. So search for Joe. Okay. So I need the full term to match. Okay. So maybe we need to fix that. Okay, Joe. Oh, and Joe Smith. Okay. And Smith Joe. Ah, we have Smith Joe now. We fix something, right? That's cool. We introduce a new issue, but we fix something. That's good. Let's search for France. Oh, cool. France Gaël is on the top of the list now, right? And you can see I also put here the score, which is the like the relevancy computation that we did on Elasticsearch side, and we can see that France Gaël, within the name field, France, is much more relevant, and by default, we sort the result set by the score, okay? So that's the reason it's on the top of the list. What can I, oh, I can search for the gender as well, okay, male, and what have you. Okay, so let's have a look at the advanced search. Joe Smith, okay, living in France, living in Paris. Let's have a look at all the Joe. Okay, so it's kind of working, not with the subterms though, so we need to fix that. So we have that thing to fix, and we have something else to fix, this number, okay? We have been slowing down a lot the injection rate, so I'm not happy with that, and we need to fix that. We are going to fix that now. So, what is the problem? Here, anytime I'm calling this method, I'm sending a HTTP request to Elasticsearch. Elasticsearch has to parse the request and then execute, index, and then send the result back. This is one of the reasons I'm slowing down everything. And instead of doing that, we should use what we call the bulk API. And in Java, we have a very nice interface. So bulk API, what is it? Basically, it's like doing a batch of requests and sending a batch of 10,000 requests altogether within one HTTP call only. Okay, it's like the batch mode. In Java, In Java, we have a very nice class named the bulk processor. And bulk processor basically is doing a lot of magic for us. So I'm creating here an instance of the bulk processor, and I'm saying I'm going to add requests to the bulk processor, and every 10,000 requests flush what you have inside Elasticsearch. Okay, every 10,000 flush. And I'm also saying that even though you don't have 10,000 requests within your bulk processor, every 5 seconds, flush what you have, if you have something. Okay. So I just need to change that. Instead of writing directly and using the client, I'm going to use the bulk processor, and I'm going to add the index request to the bulk processor. And you can do the same thing for updates, deletes, or whatever. Okay. So I think it will be faster. We are going to check that later. I don't want to relaunch now. I hope that it will fix the rate. But I want to fix something else, which is the fact that when I'm searching for Joe, G-O, it does not match. So why this? The problem that we have, and we can look at the Kibana console now, is that Elasticsearch is creating a schema by default. Anytime you are sending data and you don't set anything to Elasticsearch, Elasticsearch is trying to guess what you want to do. And sometimes it's not exactly what you want to do. So the schema, you can access it using the underscore mapping here, calling this API. And if we look at the schema that we have, so this is what has been generated by Elasticsearch. Let's have a look at the name field. What I'm just saying here, for the name field, I will index it as a text, which means that I want to run full text search on it. But behind the scene, it means that we are going to create what we call an inverted index in Lucene, and we are using Lucene inside Elasticsearch. And to build this inverted index, we need to analyze the text that you want to index to build this inverted index. And what does the analyze process is doing? We can simulate that with the analyze API here. So if I want to index something like Joe Smith, like this, why not? using the default standard analyzer, which is applied if you don't say anything to Elasticsearch, this is going to produce two tokens, Joe and Smith. And this is what is going to be indexed in the inverted index. Think about the inverted index as what you have at the end of the book, okay? Terms and ID of the page, right? Same here, you have terms and the ID of the object. So what happened at search time? When you search for something, the same analyzer by default is applied to what the user is searching. So if I'm searching for Joe, G-O, this is producing this token, G-O, lowercase here. And if you compare that with the inverted index, G-O does not match G-O-E. That's the issue that we have. That's the reason when we are searching for G-O-E, it match, but when we are searching for G-O, it does not match. Okay. So what can we do to fix that? We can provide our own analyzer. And I'm going to simulate that here with that example. Let's remove the test index, does not exist. I'm going to create an index named test, and I'm going to provide here my own analyzer. And for this analyzer, I'm calling it ngram. And I'm going to use what we call a ngram tokenizer. The ngram tokenizer here is configured as an edge ngram tokenizer. And you will see the effect in a moment. So let's create this. And now, if I'm analyzing the same Joe Smith sentence with the ngram analyzer, if we look at what we have, we can see that the tokens that I'm going to produce are different. I'm going to produce G, G-O, G-O-E, S, S-M, S-M-I, etc., etc. Okay? So I'm going to index that then, which means that when I'm going to search with Joe, G-O, I will find it in the inverted index, so I will be able to find my document. So let's remove that. Okay. How much time do I have? 12 minutes? Okay. So to do that, I'm going to use a library that I built. The name is Beyonder. So this is open source on my GitHub project. And to use, Beyonder is going to help you to create the index automatically with all the settings. You can do that manually. I can delete the index person and just put the settings like this. But instead of doing that, I can just use Beyonder and create those settings. So before creating that, I just want to explain what I'm going to do. When I'm going to create the index person, I'm going to define the analyzer that we have seen here, with the ngram strategy that I mentioned before. And I'm going to provide an explicit mapping here. So let's have a look at the name field again. What I'm saying that by default, if you search within the name field, it will be a full text kind of field. But I'm not specifying any analyzer yet. What I'm doing here, I'm copying at index time the content of the name field within a field named full text. If we look at the full text definition, I can see that I'm using this ngram strategy that I mentioned, which means that everything which goes in the full text field will be ngrammed, basically. I'm doing the same thing for overfield, like address.city. So by default, we will use the standard analyzer if we search within the address.city field, but we are copying the content to full text again. And we are doing something else. For the address.city field, at index time, we are going to generate dynamically subfields. One of the subfields is named autocomplete, so address.city.autocomplete, where I'm going to use the same ngram strategy that I mentioned before. Why not? And I'm also going to generate address.city.ags. I'm going to say, OK, this time you are going to see the content of the field as a keyword field, which means that you can run sorting and aggregation on top of that. And I'm going to use that later. And I'm doing the same thing for country field and some other fields. Yeah, location also is a specific thing. I'm using the type geopoint. Not really going to use that, but you will see that in Kibana later. OK, so I have this definition, and I want to create those settings. So with Beyonder, what I can do, I can, when I start my client here, I can say, okay, let's call Elasticsearch Beyonder class, start with the client, sclient.lowlevel, and so on with try-catch. Okay, anytime this is going to be called, the Beyonder project is going to look within the class path if there is a directory named Elasticsearch by convention. And if you have any other directory within this one, then it will be the index you need to create. So person, I need to create an index named person. And then I can create a file here. If the file name is _settings.json, and then I have some troubles always. Yeah. I don't know why my IDE is always complaining here. So I need to do something like compare with branch, mapping. Okay, let's do that. So I'm basically copying and pasting the definition of the index here. That's it. I think I'm done. I removed the indexed. I did, just checking. Yes. So I can restart again, but now let's restart in debug mode. Oops. Debug mode. I expect to see a nice message from Beyonder. Rock and roll means everything is okay. That's cool. So if I look, just checking, if I look at the mapping that I have now, okay. I can see that Beyonder has created the index with all the settings that I want. We need to index again some documents. So, oops, not here. Let's index again 1,000 documents to see what is happening. Okay, it's better, not that fast, but better. We will see that in a second. Okay, I have my documents now. If I'm searching for GO, it does not work. Why? No one can help me here? Okay, I'm doing that myself. Why it is? Because I'm still searching within the name field, and I mentioned that I did not touch how the name field is indexed, right? I'm still using the standard thing. So, here, instead of searching in name, gender, address.country, address.city, I can search within the full text field now, which is produced at index time. More interesting, what I can say is that if what the user has entered match on the name field, I want to boost the result, which means that I want the score to be much higher because it matches on the name field. Okay? Name is much more important to me than full text field. So basically, this is what I'm saying here. Oops. Let's compile that and see what is happening. Let's search for G. Oh, so now GO is working. And as you can see, GOE, exact match, it's okay. Let's search for France. Okay. FranceGal is on the top of the list. You can see the score, which is much higher because of the boost factor that I mentioned just before. Okay, so search is okay, but full advanced search does not work either. Why this? I'm still searching in the name field. So now I need to search within the name.autocomplete field. Same for country, same for city. Autocomplete is just a name that I give to the field, right? So if I'm searching now for G, living in France, living in Paris. Okay, we are back. Okay, we have our what we used to have before. Cool. So let's go back to this number. Obviously, this is slowing down the process. But what I would like to see is how fast can be Elasticsearch, actually, when you index documents inside Elasticsearch. So let's do something really simple here in the save method. Let's remove the call to the database. And let's just index data inside Elasticsearch. I need to change something else here. Because I'm not generating an ID from Hibernate anymore, I need to ask Elasticsearch to generate an ID for me. So this is what I did. Let's compile that. And let's see with, I'm confident, so let's see with 10,000. Done. OK, so it's fast. So I can index 1 million documents, for example. Sorry? Yes, I'm waiting for the request to be processed on Elasticsearch side. Yes, because I need to have the response back from the bulk processor. Say that again? I didn't get that, sorry. Let's talk about that after. Okay? So, because this is a search engine, this is super fast at searching whatever the number of data that you have. So I can search for Joe, for example, Steele, Smith, what have you, France, whatever the number of data that you have. And same for the advanced search. Because we have a lot of data coming to the Elasticsearch system now, maybe we want to understand how our data set our result set is made of. So what is the distribution of the people by country, for example, or by date of birth? To do that, we can add, where is that, here, what we call aggregations. So let's put that here. Aggregation. No, I'm going to cheat. Demo. So I'm going to build a first aggregation. The name is by country. This is the name that I'm giving to the aggregation. I'm doing a terms aggregation on this field address.country.ags. What does it mean? I'm going to do like a group by count ordered by the most important values on this field. And what I want to do here with this over aggregation, I want to build a date histogram on the date of birth field. And what I'm doing, I want to generate a bucket for every year and count the number of documents you have per year, basically. So let's do that. On the front end, I had everything ready yet. So if I'm searching again for my result, so I'm done with the 1 million documents. Okay. So if I'm searching for Joe, for example, I can see the distribution of my Joe broken per country or broken per 10 years. Okay. What time is it? I'm short. So, let's do something more advanced. Let's replace this one by what I call the compute thing. So here, I have the same first aggregation, terms aggregation on this field. Then, for every single bucket of country, I want to compute the distribution of my documents per country, then per 10 years. And then for every 10 years, I want to compute an average value of the number of children that I have. So let's modify really quickly this. I can do that on the front end. I'm not a front end guy, but this is something I can do. OK, if I look at the compute button now, I have the representation of what I just mentioned. Distribution per country, then per 10 years, then the average number of children. And if you search for Joe, then you have all the data. You understand what you have here behind the scene. I would like to just introduce. I will be running out of time. But I just want to show you how you can deal with typos here. You can add what we call a fuzziness factor, which is I'm allowing one edit distance in the terms. So if I'm searching for G Smurf, now I can see that I have my results back. Okay, last, I can use Kibana for what it has been built for. I'm going to create an index pattern name person here. I have a date of birth field. And I just want here in the management to re-import some visualization. So where is that? It's here. here, yes, yes. So what you are going to see here is a dashboard that I have been generated on Kibana side, so based on the document. So this is running aggregation that I just mentioned, but now I'm able to visualize all that, right? So I have some representation, terms aggregation here, distribution by year, as I mentioned. I can use the geolocation point and to see how many people I have in this part of the country, for example, if I'm searching for Joe. Okay, so I have my distribution of Joe, who are females, who are living in Sergi, where I'm living. And you can zoom in if you search for all the data now, like this. This is all the female living in Sergi, and I also can drill, try to find people living here. Cool. And I have my result set here. Okay? So whatever data you are injecting in the Elasticsearch, then you can play with just putting Kibana on top of that, and then you're done. I'm done with the session. I'm running out of time, so I don't have time for questions right now, but I will answer that on slido.com. I have stickers in the front, so if you want to grab some stickers. And thank you, and enjoy the rest of the day.